Welcome everybody to the meeting tonight for the Planning Commission for Addison Township. If everybody please stand, pledge of allegiance to the flag.
Oh, it's your name, man.
It's right here.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
It's terminology.
I don't know.
It's the only way a permit can be issued.
Okay.
It's for a wastewater treatment system.
Do you want to take the roll call?
It's in the code.
Yes. Laura Smith is not here. Vice Chair Jean Lourd.
Here.
Secretary Ben's here. Linda Garrick.
Present.
Bill Marshall, he'll be here. Chuck Sargent.
Present.
And Joe Schnur.
Here.
Is there any announcements or correspondence? Not, we'll move on to the approval of the agenda for tonight.
I move that we approve it.
Do you have an approval in a second? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, next we have the approval of the February 14th meeting.
I didn't find anything in there.
I motion the minutes of the PC meeting for February 14, 2017 be approved as submitted.
Okay, we have a motion, any seconds?
I second it.
We have a motion and a second, any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed, same sign? Yeah. Then we move on to item two. Parcel ID number 0508-100-006-2775 Oakwood Road. The applicants are Larry and Amanda Shelton. It's to refer the findings of the Planning Commission to the building official for consideration of a zoning compliance permit for the building to be used solely for private, non-commercial use. The standards set forth in the Township Zoning Ordinance Article 6, Agricultural, Section 6.02, 14, Private Riding Arena, and Section 6.04.10, L1, 2, 3, and 4. Mr. Shelton, would you have any brief comments to make?
Other than that, what we've already stated on the record, the fact that we're going to abide by the ordinances, believe that the deed restriction that was requested was burdensome, as well as not required in the ordinance, and that we believe that, as stated, we will abide by the ordinance as it's outlined in the law, and based on my summary, what we said last time, nothing else to add, unless there's questions of me.
Okay, sir, thank you. Is there any comments from or questions from the board? Joe?
Go ahead.
I feel that it's nice that they do that. However, if I were a neighbor and they moved or sold the place, how the neighbor and someone else started to commercialize the place, how would the neighbors know how to stop that? I know it's going to be in the rules. It's going to be in the documentation here. But how would they know to get to that documentation?
Well, in my opinion, there would probably be a complaint that goes along with the, you know, with that. If they do file a complaint, then I think that's why, you know, the building official would then look into it. And if it is being used for commercial use, then he would be able to stop it at that time.
Well, he can only stop it, according to this paper, if they refer to the meeting here that says that they will not do that. That's the documentation that says that they can't do that.
Well, Joe, I think that would be in his, it would seem to me that would be what he would research before he went out there to see if it was, if they were in compliance, or if he went out there because there was a complaint.
Uh-huh.
When he came back, it would seem to me he would research it to make sure that they're in compliance.
That piece of paper this meeting information.
That would be administrative, where they would have that on file with this address.
Oh, okay.
Once they pull up the address, they'd see that case.
It would go with the address, even though they leave or move or whatever?
I believe so. Is that correct, Pauline?
Is that...
I'm kind of remaining in the DC meetings.
I think, if I may, that would be included in the disclosure statement. If an owner decides to sell a property, there is a disclosure statement. It would probably be disclosed in that statement that the writing stable is for personal use only, not commercial.
That's good. I can buy that.
Okay.
I had a question. To make it commercial, it would take quite a bit of further building, because you're just putting the arena in a, like a storage area, right?
Yes, ma'am.
And you only have four stalls at the present, correct?
Yes, ma'am.
I mean, you have four horses. You got a small barn.
Yeah, I have a small barn, yes.
So if they wanted to go commercial, they'd have to be building stalls on the interior or adding on to the sucker.
Yes, ma'am.
That would show a lot of activity to clue the neighbors in, I would think.
Yes, ma'am. And again, the leasing mechanism is the same. Whether the property owners, the adjoining property owners, I would have to come back for permission to do a commercial for the ordinance. I would have to come back. Again, that's all public record.
Yeah.
But whether it's a deed restriction or it's for the ordinance, the policing mechanism is still.
Because it would not be a simple thing to like switch it over after it's built.
It would not.
It could be done, but it would not be
a cheap endeavor.
I don't have any problem with you doing this, and I think it's a good thing that you're doing. Only thing I was worried about is how can the neighbors solve the problem if it turns out to be commercial. But what Sergeant said, Chuck Sargent said, is that it will be, it should be on
the disclosures.
The disclosure.
Mm-hmm. I'm happy. That's great.
Because mm-hmm. we have it on record, you and your wife said no, so.
Yes, ma'am. We stand by the record. Okay.
Any other questions of the board? It's my understanding we go through the ordinance.
I did ask.
To see if you know how we feel on these things here. It's no public or priding arena over 4,500 square feet in area shall be permitted unless Planning Commission shall find that it is designed, located, and operated in such a manner and under such conditions that each of the following applies. And we just need a consensus on these four items. The public health, safety, welfare will not be adversely affected.
Oh, yes.
Okay.
We do not think it will be adversely affected.
Yep. It will be compatible with adjacent land uses.
Yes.
No living quarters will be located in the arena building. Consensus on it?
No.
And if a private riding arena, it will be used only for horses that are permanently stabled on the same property and will not become a commercial venture, which would generate non-residential traffic.
You stated consensus. It wouldn't, so.
Yeah.
Okay.
Let's go. Okay. Well, in that case, I think we, based on the findings, if everybody's in agreement, we need a motion based on those findings.
I move that we allow the building of the arena as long as it does fit all the parameters that we have discussed. And
okay, I think what we're doing is just agreeing that they've met all these conditions for us to forward this to the building official. So if we make a motion to that effect, okay.
They have met items 1, 2, 3, and 4 as private use only, and it is our recommendation that it goes forth to the
building official. Okay, we got a motion. Do I hear a second?
A second.
Got a second?
Yes.
Any further discussion?
Clarification, this motion would then
send your findings on to the building inspector, who will make a zoning compliance determination.
Okay. Okay, Mr. Schultz. Any further discussion?
That determination then goes?
No.
Goes nowhere?
Correct.
If he issues, he doesn't.
If the building inspector should find that the matter's not zoning compliant, he would advise the applicant as to the reasons, and there then may be remedies, but we'll wait for that determination by the building inspector.
Okay, so amended, do I say?
No, I think it's good. No, that's good.
All right.
Any further discussion? Okay, we have a motion. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed, same sign. Motion's passed, send it to the building inspector. Third thing on there is discussion of possible text amendments, definitions, lot area, and lake lot district overlay section 13.03.3. I guess we need to have a discussion on first lake lot or lot area. And Rand, do you want to?
Thank you.
Take over.
Lot area may be easier of the two, a little more straightforward. In a recent land division case, the township attorney observed that the consideration of bottom lands in the zoning ordinance was not addressed. In a conversation with him, he recommended that we use the Michigan Public Act 451 language, which addresses bottom lands. You were given that definition on November 1st, which is basically areas larger than 5 acres. So if there's a pond or a lake under 5 acres, the bottom land area of under 5 acres could be considered part of lot area. So what you have here is potential language, which would redefine lot area by eliminating bottom land as part of the lot area calculation. The underlying portion is the new language that's being considered. The non-underlined portion is as presently written in the ordinance, so this would expand the definition. The schedule of regulations also refers to this definition, so we would want the schedule of regulations to refer the reader of the ordinance to the new definition, so that the reader of the ordinance understood what lot area now means. As mentioned in this memo, your comments will be helpful in finalizing wording for some future public hearing if we do have consensus on the wording. Be glad to address questions you may have.
And then on, like, your memo, the wording at the bottom would be added in addition to that, the certified inspector.
I'm addressing now the definition
just
of
a lot
area.
Okay. All right.
And then we'll move on to lake area.
Okay.
Considerations.
What are you saying, Kurt? This underlined area.
Okay.
Any other questions from the board?
I think the wording is clear and unambiguous.
What is our action tonight?
This is just for discussion.
Thank you. I think it looks good.
Anything else? Joe?
Nope, okay.
Any comments from the...
What does that do to the defined taxable lot size?
That I don't have an answer for that, sir.
Because right now, my understanding is that there's a different tax rate applied to
under, or what's the...
The bottom lands?
The bottom lands than to surface land, but there is some tax liability for bottom lands. Does that change with this?
The definition doesn't change what bottom lands are.
This is for...
So it's still considered part of your lot?
This is for zoning applications. I don't think it applies to assessing.
The assessing department, the assessor would be better able to answer the question as to how a definition change in the zoning ordinance may or may not affect tax assessment. We are unable to answer that. No action is being taken tonight, so there will be opportunity to get an answer to that before the language is even considered in a public hearing.
Okay. Thanks. Anything else?
Thank you.
Right. Move on to
the next item has a little more history to it. In February of last year, you did what you were asked to do by the Zoning Board of Appeals, and that was look at whether or not a text amendment might be warranted to reduce the frequency of variance requests for septic setbacks in lake lot areas. The chairman sent a memo to his colleagues on the Zoning Board of Appeals suggesting some guidelines or considerations that they may look at in granting variances or considering variances, namely looking at the soil's conditions as a determinant of the extent to which a setback may be allowed, and whether engineered systems using artificial medium rather than soils for treatment or full pretreatment facilities may be warranted. That memo was did not accomplish the intended purpose. It was interpreted other than what it was intended. Consequently, the township board has asked us to revisit the question and look at whether or not a text amendment might be warranted to reduce the frequency of variance requests for setback for septics from the lake lot area.
I didn't hear that last part. They want us to do what?
Consider whether or not a text amendment is warranted to minimize the frequency of setback requests through the Zoning Board of Appeals, while maintaining the environmental protections that that setback is intended to establish. The response thus far has been for the township attorney to draft language that might be considered. That language was tabled in November, is back before you now. And a colleague commissioner has offered language which was distributed to you as well, which is intended, I believe, to accomplish the same purposes of minimizing the frequency of variance requests, of expediting the process by which a citizen might get relief from that setback requirement. So that brings us up to date on where we are. I can't answer your questions regarding the attorney's language, but we can reflect them in the minutes and ask him to respond if there are questions of his language. And we're honored to have the author of the other language with us tonight, who may be able to address questions on the other language. No action tonight, merely discussion. We have the benefit of citizen comment as well as we consider this going forward.
I just had, it must might be word nuances between the two, but I had a question where it says on the memo that engineered certified process, is that the same thing as on the rewording on-site waste treatment system permit issued by Oakland County Health Department?
No.
Pardon?
No.
No?
No.
Can you explain the difference there? Chuck, go ahead and explain what the difference to them.
They're not certified,
well,
or what?
I guess if I may, Mr. Chairman, by a show of hands, how many commissioners present this evening has read the Oakland County Health Division Sanitary Code Article 3, which was previously distributed to us.
Skimmed it, yes.
I read the whole thing, but I don't remember all.
Okay. So, four of the five present have read that article, because the term wastewater treatment system is specified in that code. Now, to have a meaningful conversation or discussion on the setback and the differences between the text proposed by Attorney Davis and the text that I drafted, since we have read the code, four of us, then for those of us who have read the code, and for those who will read the code, we learn that there are three wastewater treatment systems that can be permitted: an alternative system, a conventional system, and an alternative engineered system. Both the language drafted by Attorney Davis and the language drafted by yours truly intend to accomplish the same purpose when it comes to the applicant. And it is the applicant that's going to trigger the action. And it makes it easier for an applicant to, after meeting certain criteria, which is specified in the sanitary code, to reduce from 100-foot setback, which is the current ordinance 1303.3, to not less than 50 feet, which is what the requirement is by the Hogan County Health Division. It eliminates the process of going to the ZBA with petition for variance. Now, that said, we have the two texts in front of us. I'd like to refer to them as text one, being that authored by Attorney Davis, and text two, being offered by yours truly. I assert that the text provided by Attorney Davis requires an alternative system. In fact, it may well mandate an alternative system.
To satisfy the 50-foot thing.
Well, the language reads that the applicant, the setback can be reduced from 100 feet from the normal high water mark to not less than 50 feet, provided the applicant submits an engineered certified process that will accomplish the same 50 feet as it would at 100 feet.
That's your
That's not mine. I am asserting, or I am saying, due to research, that it may well mandate a alternative system. Should an alternative system be mandated, my thinking is, and I have confirmed these thoughts, if an alternative system is mandated, then the opportunity for an applicant to install or gain permit, a wastewater treatment permit, for a conventional system, it's not available, because the ordinance mandates or requires an engineered certified process. And I'll come back to you in a second if I may. I have had three different conversations with Oakland County Health Division, specifically with Michael Pilar, and should you recall, Michael Pilar is the senior sanitarian for Oakland County Health Division. He is responsible for this area. Mike, on the 13th of December 2016, made a presentation to this commission and had a question and answer period. I asked a question at that time, and I will paraphrase the question. If an applicant is required to submit a engineer-certified process that will accomplish the same filtration at 50 feet from a high water mark as it will from 100 feet from the high water mark, what is your thinking? Alternative system, pretreatment, I recommend Elgin. On the 16th of February, I had a phone conversation with Mr. Pilar, and we talked about the requirements that are in Article 3 of the Sanitary Code. We talked about setback here. Again, he confirmed that it would require at minimum pretreatment. As recent as last week, on March 9, I had another conversation with Mr. Pilar because I attended a sanitary code, a septic workshop at the Orion Library, which was hosted jointly between the Oakland County Health Division and Michigan State University. A separate senior sanitarian conducted that workshop. During the workshop, I asked a similar question immediately, no hesitation. Pre-treatment, it requires an alternative system. So, that being said, and if confirmed to be fact, then the attorney language requires pretreatment. It eliminates a conventional system for many people who own lakefront lots in the township. Example, we have the Lakefield Lake District. That's the largest body in the township, correct?
Yeah.
If we look at the records, there is a special assessment district. And that special assessment district memorializes or identifies approximately 260 parcels in that special assessment district. Of the 260 parcels, approximately 198 of those parcels are non-conforming, less than 1 acre, less than 1 acre in surface area. A conventional system is available to those parcels. And if a alternative system is mandated or required, then a conventional system is not available. And because of that, I think it creates a hardship, a disproportionate burden on those lakefront lot owners in the township, and specifically this SAD.
So they'll just apply for a variance?
No, the variance would not apply.
Why?
What I'm saying is that the language that requires an applicant to submit an engineered certified process, according to the Oakland County Health Division, two separate senior sanitarians, it requires pretreatment, which identifies an alternative system. And if we do the math, if there are 260 people in that or parcels in that special assessment district, 198 being less than 1 acre, if we do the math, it's 73%, approximately 73% of the people which may be denied opportunity for a conventional system, which creates a financial hardship. So, that being said, for this discussion, I suggest two things. One, obviously, the language be returned to Attorney Davis for further legal analysis, and that contact be made with Mr. Pilar, who is the decision maker for this area, to confirm that it would require pretreatment. And should you recall, having read the code, the health official makes the determination as to which permit can be issued to the applicant by being on site, watching a backhoe go down as far as 10, 12 feet, and two of the most important criteria for issuance of a permit is soil absorption and filtration distance from the high water mark. So I think that we need verification, clarification from both the attorney and the health division. And I will say the health division trumps.
Does what?
Trumps.
It trumps, yes, correct.
But the health division controls. They control the law. They trump the ordinance. And
I'd hate to swim in a lake just because if they were inconvenienced.
Oh, of course. Yeah. But the primary purpose of the effort of Attorney Davis and myself is to protect the environment and comply with two very important and clear septic needs. One, it has to have direction of flow away from the water. So I just think more research is needed so we can move forward with more productive discussion.
I think that's why we're here. Well, we're here tonight to discuss that.
Sure.
People's ideas.
Sure.
Whether, you know, we like Mr. Davis's, we like yours, a blend of the two, or if there's something
sure.
else that we need. I know from some of my experience with the health department, Mr. Pilar from time to time gets changed to other districts.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it's probably to our benefit if we go to his senior.
Paladin?
Well, whoever is in charge of mm-hmm. her. So when we, mm-hmm. do, when
sure.
we do get a remark, you know, hopefully we wouldn't go to someplace down in Troy and go to another sanitary thing and have another sanitarian down there say something different. This way we get it from one person who leads, you
well,
know,
true.
Who's in charge of that.
Very true.
You know.
And I think there was a list of questions directed to Mr. Pilar, and there was response to those questions previously, but I agree with what you're saying. Yes.
You answered my question, you forgot it, didn't you? No, you answered
okay.
it. There was the three systems. I didn't understand what you meant about the alternative.
Okay.
Yeah, I think
the and I know because of time and your recent appointment to this commission, do you have a copy of Article 3?
I will find it.
Okay. Because those definitions are contained therein.
I guess I'm just wondering, you know, we're being tasked with changing language.
I can't hear you very well.
We're being tasked with discussing language to change the zoning ordinance for something that I think protects the lake. And I don't know enough about what's going on with the lake really to, you know, to comment. I wondered how long it's been since the lake was tested. If we looked at E. coli before and after rains, and, you know.
The answer to the last question is it's tested annually. And in fact, we have one of the people responsible for a portion of the testing present, Mr. Benazinski.
Who is that?
The testing is done yearly.
By?
By
whom?
By people designated and trained to take water samples, by specific location of taking those water samples, GPS location, that comes from the Oakland County Health Division. The samples are then returned to the Oakland County Health Division down at the tank plant, and they test those samples, provide reports. Those reports are then consolidated, and there is a history of those reports, which is also recorded at the Clinton River Cooperative. So it's very well tested, and the test results have been favorable.
Not just once a year.
Pardon me?
Not just once a year.
No, no, it's more than once.
I'm just saying, because, you know, temperature, rain, all of that plays.
Oh, of course, yes.
Sorry, you had.
The lake is healthy.
There's two people that I'm aware of that are doing testing. I am doing water testing for the Cooperative Lakes Management or Monitoring Program through the state of Michigan. I do chlorophyll, phosphorus, SecuDisc, which is clarity testing. Clarity testing is done once a week through the summer. Phosphorus is done in the spring. In fact, I was on the lake Sunday to take my phosphorus sample, and in the fall at the end of the season. And chlorophyll is taken once a month through the summer months. This year, we're going to add dissolved oxygen to those other three tests, and that's going to be every other week through the summer. And again, my data is turned into the Cooperative Lakes Monitoring Program through the state of Michigan. They analyze the samples and provide results to us annually with trends over the years. We've been doing this for probably 20 years now and have trends for that 20 years from the Cooperative Lakes Managing Program. In addition to the testing that I do, another resident on his own, Tom Malaszewski, does E. coli testing. Two or three times a year, he goes out and samples the lake in three different locations. Once in the north end, center, and the south end of the lake. He submits that information to the health department in Pontiac, and they test, or they monitor E. coli in those test samples. All of the results that we received, and I know Tom's been doing it for at least 5 years now, all of the results that he's reported for the last 5 years have been well within the state standards for E. coli.
And I think, if I may, if there's five consecutive years testing history, the CLMP graphs that and reports it on an annual basis.
If I may, E. coli testing.
On the oxygen, you do it at various levels, correct?
The dissolved oxygen we have not done in the past. We are adding it this summer. And basically, I think you take every 5 foot increment.
Because I've done it before, you have to, and the temperature plays a huge.
Correct. This will be the first year we've done.
You got to take the temperature of the thing and record all of the. It's fun to do.
Linda?
I just know from experience, I work near Metro Beach, and they test the water after it rains. They test it every day. But after it rains, the E. coli jumps. And mm-hmm. they believe that it's directly related to the septic fields that are very aged in the area. And I wondered if Lakeville Lake had a before and after rain E. coli change in the numbers, and whether the septic played any part in that.
I don't think our current E. coli testing is frequent enough to give you that answer.
But the phosphorus would jump.
And again, that's twice this summer, once in the spring, once in the fall. So
the most recent report indicates that there's a slight uptick.
After rain, it would have to for the loss.
Chopper, you mentioned that there are several, more than 200 non-compliant lots on the lake, right?
176.
Approximately 198.
Okay, now, you said some of them can have regular drain fields.
Mm-hmm.
And they're not in compliance right now.
No, they're in compliance.
I see.
They're in compliance. The point that I was attempting to make is that if in fact text one requires alternative system, then those persons, some of the 198 people, lakefront lot owners who have less than 1 acre, are denied the opportunity to install a conventional system.
I don't understand that.
Because if text one, and that is Attorney David's language, as it currently reads, requires the applicant to submit an engineered certified process. And an engineered certified process is specific in the code, and it requires pretreatment. And the pretreatment reduces the solids before it goes to the septic for treatment, and eventually when the effluent hits the field, it's in finer particles. So it does improve filtration. But all lots in the current special assessment district, approximately 260 of them, to my knowledge, are currently compliant. It's only in the event there would be a new construction in the district or a replacement system that would require a wastewater treatment permit. And the terminology wastewater treatment system is septic, but it's that treatment system. So everybody now, Joe, is, to my understanding, compliant. It's for the applicants that are looking for new systems or replacement systems.
I see.
Any other questions? Discussion? From the, sir?
Chuck, if I understand your point, the language drafted by Attorney Davis would mandate an alternative system whether or not a conventional system would satisfy the Oakland County requirements.
It would require it, yes.
So the distinction is Attorney Davis's language automatically forces you into an alternative system, whereas Chuck's language, if I understand it properly, would say we're going to reduce the setback from 100 to 50 feet, but we're going to let Oakland County Sanitation Department determine what type of system is necessary in that case.
Yes.
In my opinion, sir, they're going to do that anyways.
Yes.
The Oakland County Health Department is going to determine what kind of system you need. I think the discussion here tonight is about whether we go, whether that person has to go to the ZBA. Is that correct, Chuck? Part of the discussion here is,
well, as
try to eliminate people from going to
the, yes, as Mr. Bowman said earlier, yeah. The history, the chronological history of how this came to be, and it actually originated in 2015, mm-hmm. Because the ZBA felt that they were receiving, and the calculation is approximately 3% of applications have to do with septic variance. So that's the, yes, that's the purpose of it.
Can I just, I know I'm new and trying to understand this, but if why are we writing an ordinance if the health department is going to issue a permit and they're saying 50 feet is good, they're going to say whatever system is right at 50 feet. Doesn't your ordinance say the same thing? The health department is going to issue a permit, and if they say 50, they might come out and say we got a greater system now and it'll work at 25 feet.
Yes,
but it can happen. Maybe we don't even need to have that ordinance. The attorney's ordinance is saying is more restrictive and is looking towards protecting the lakefront more, if I'm understanding, and requiring people to have an engineered certified process.
Mm-hmm.
I think the county is requiring an engineer process to some extent, if they're saying it'll work, no? Well, you're saying...
Not true.
Okay, all right, so, but your thing is saying that if the health department can come up with an onsite wastewater treatment, which is in this sanitary code 3, or no, am I missing something?
Well, they could come up with new systems. A alternative engineered system is a myriad of configurations. It could require different media for pretreatment. It could require chamber baffles and interior baffle trunk pumps and everything. And some of these systems can run. I am aware of one system of $67,000. And that's the burden that I'm saying may come back to the applicant if they are required to have an alternative system. There is an alternative system that was recently installed on the lake. It went in front of the ZBA. ZBA granted a setback variance. The system was installed. They dug down and hit water at 4 feet. The resulting system that was installed, and this is the Tobian property, was $42,000. And they elevated those tanks 5 feet above the natural grade, which created a higher elevation to the contiguous property, created runoff, and now they have water going toward the shoreline that is creating ditches. So these alternative systems and the engineered systems, although they are effective, they are expensive. And if a person can install a conventional system to the satisfaction of the Oakland County Health Division, specifically Article 3, then let that happen. The setback from 100 feet to not less than 50 feet applies to both texts. Any septic that is installed less than 50 feet mandates an alternative engineered system by the health department. And Article 3 also reads that Article 3 must be adhered to by all municipalities, by all townships in Oakland County. So it is the king card in the deck. And I asked about that I asked Mr. Pilar if the health division trumps or overrules existing ordinance in Addison Township. He said yes. He said we carry that big stick as a figure of speech, but he said what we seek to do is to cooperate with the different governmental agencies and work together. He said it's working so far.
I think that the local ordinance is more restrictive than what the state or the county, that's why we have ordinance. He said that they trump us?
Yes.
Mr. Rand, is that true?
When it comes in terms of human health protection, that is a case. However, this township is addressing environmental concerns. Mm-hmm. Which is, I would suggest, Chuck knows where I'm going, minimized by county health departments. So the issue is are we regulating public health or are we regulating environmental contamination?
Both.
And why is it in a zoning ordinance? Why isn't it in our code of ordinances?
I can't answer that question. However, Article 3 became effective the 15th of November 2016, so it is new. And I am thankful for the cooperative effort coming from the OCHD and Michael Pilar and his supervisor are very cooperative and willing to explain requirements, answer questions, and for the purpose of our discussion tonight, I think we'll see that perhaps additional information or confirmation, clarification is needed from reliable sources to help us come to a conclusion on proposed language, if we do come to a conclusion, and make that proposal.
And if indeed the Planning Commission changes its consensus, which in February last year was that the Zoning Board of Appeals could merely use soils conditions as the determinant of any variance, I'm laboring on the impression that if a property owner walks in the door of the ZBA with health department acceptable solutions, that the ZBA will always grant a variance under those circumstances. Mm-hmm. Whether it's a conventional system or an engineered system or a pretreatment system. Mm-hmm. I'm confident that the health department is going to recommend what it believes is best under the soils conditions. Mm-hmm. That's what we endeavored to say to the ZBA 14 months ago.
Which is, why do we have an ordinance?
I believe the reason, the rationale for the ordinance is predominantly environmental protection. What is unsaid is that frequently the cause of the variance is a desire to, what I will say, overbuild on a too small lot.
It doesn't leave them much room for
rather than a failed septic system. I think our records reflect that. If you have a failed system, everyone, I think, it's in everyone's interests to quickly get a health department approved system in place, and the Zoning Board of Appeals has been accommodating of that. However, I think we've been accommodating of expanding the footprints of homes beyond perhaps what is warranted under the circumstances.
Maybe we should be looking at a zoning ordinance for that. If you have new construction that you need to leave.
I think currently it's limited to 15% of the surface area.
I don't know. Like,
what happens is the 50% is not exceeded, but people go up in the air and add mm-hmm. bedrooms.
Mm-hmm. It's the bedroom count, which the new code for a 3 or 4 bedroom house, new installation, or a replacement septic system requires a 1,500 gallon tank.
2 compartment.
Yes. And may require at a minimum 2,400 square feet. If the property of record is defined prior to January, and I think it's 1964, they're exempted. Repairs can be made to the current system. A 1,000 gallon tank is grandfathered. No pretreatment is necessary as long as the soil absorption and the filtration distance from the high water mark are met.
Mr. Chairman, you've accomplished your task tonight, which is to discuss the matter.
We've done that, so.
No action required this evening.
Okay.
I had a question for you. Have you ever thought of getting the university to do a 24-hour test in their science department? Those are fun to do.
It hasn't been discussed with anything I'm familiar with.
I mean, that would be, you could get a biology department to do something like that yearly.
Let me give you something.
It really does show dramatically of all the things.
For E. coli.
E. coli, phosphorus, the
it's not stapled.
Everything.
But it's in order.
Oh, okay. Do you want me to have your copy?
I have 2 copies. I have another.
we would go out to the lake and take our samples.
No, you can have it.
Once every hour, 24 hours, and do all the testing in between the hours.
Which university is this?
That was Central Michigan University.
We can move on.
Students like to do it.
Sorry. Move on to public forum. So the floor is yours.
I'm good.
You're good? Okay. Commissioner reports? If there's nothing, your motion to adjourn.
So motioned. Second.
You have a motion and a second? All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Same sign? Good night.
Thank you.